September 11th, 2001 terror strikes set the tone for warfare in the 21st century. But the 21st century has also seen the rise of another kind of warfare. Warfare that lets nations and loners do battle without guns or bombs. These days, the biggest threat we face may be a rogue actor with a laptop and a desire to wreak havoc.
Cyber warfare is probably the greatest challenge that we have as far as our nation's national security is concerned. We have an advantage over every other form of competition with possible allies, except one, and that's cyber warfare. And when you see the potential of what a successful cyber attack can achieve, it's enough to make you deeply concerned.
This is going to be the new battlefield, an unseen, invisible battlefield where teams of hackers from various nations will duel.
In 2010, a computer virus named Stuxnet demolished a secret Iranian nuclear weapons plant. Hackers at Symantec Corporation unraveled its mysteries.
What made Stuxnet different was it didn't just stick to the cyber world. It actually breached and caused sort of real-world kinetic damage. It's nothing that we had ever seen before. And so Stuxnet just began spreading all around the world, onto Windows machines, everywhere. But what it was doing was it was also looking for something else. It was looking for these things that are called PLCs, or these small computers that control things like factories, like the power grid.
What you see here is the code that is put onto the PLC, and this is the normal process. Code goes onto the PLC, turns the PLC on or off, and controls it.
When we first got the code, it's literally zeros and ones. You know, it's sort of unintelligible. It was only later that we were able to determine that actually this code was targeted specifically at Iran's uranium enrichment plant in Natanz.
Uranium enrichment facilities are very secure facilities. It's not like they're connected to the internet. You can't get your code in and out in that way. So one of the ways Stuxnet was able to get into the facility was via USB key. So it was able to infect USB keys, and then somebody would bring USB key with them into the secure facility, not realizing it was infected, plug it into a computer inside, and then that computer inside would be infected.
You know, we don't know definitively who is behind Stuxnet, but it's very clear that it's a nation state, and it's nation states that had something against Iran. And it's likely that it isn't a single nation state. You have to remember as well with cyber warfare that the sort of barrier to entry is quite low. If a country wants to do something like build a nuclear missile, that's actually quite difficult. But when you talk about something like cyber warfare, it's actually quite cheap and quite easy for a country to develop a cyber weapon. And that cyber weapon can have equivalent effects. You could have a cyber weapon potentially shut down the power grid, for example, on the whole East Coast. New York is out. Wall Street is out. All your banks are out. You can't even withdraw money. You know, you can imagine people panic starting and people trying to get cash. You can't get cash. ATMs aren't working. Then things like your water waste treatment plants aren't working. There's no clean water. There's going to be a run on stores. Stores potentially aren't even operating. Your credit card is not going to work at the store. There'll be absolutely mass panic.
If you can blind the U.S. military, if you can shut down our GPS and our computer networks, our military is basically unable to function. And it could take days or weeks to get those systems back up and running. They can do tremendous damage. They can defeat your armies, your fleets, your air forces by simply blinding them, by taking down their cyber systems. I think that's a huge risk that we face.
With cyber war, I always think one of the most effective ways to fight against cyber is to find the computer and the operator and put a bullet through both of them.